And welcome to this, the first plenary of this EASA meeting entitled Contemporary Articulations of Kinship and Gender. We've got three really great speakers here. Three of our favorite anthropologists are speaking to us today. Plus, we have a wonderful and highly competent discussant as well. So we're looking very much forward to this. Before I give the floor to the first speaker, let me just explain to you how we're going to go about this. First, I'm going to say about three sentences about the subject, just to remind you, I mean, what this is about, okay? And then we move straight on to the presentations. We get all the three presentations in one slot, followed by comments by the discussants, and then, given time, a number of questions from you. So, kinship has been a central preoccupation of anthropologists forever, since Morgan, since the mid-19th century. And it's still with us, although it has been deconstructed and reconstructed many times. Gender somehow came later into the focus of anthropological theorizing and research, but it's been part of the backbone of anthropological theorizing, at least since the 1970s. Both of these categories are being continuously questioned. As you know, I mean, we anthropologists, I mean, one of the favorite things that we do is to undermine the conditions for our own theorizing. And that's the way we try to proceed in improving our understanding of the world. And the questions we are asking today, in the spirit of the overarching theme of the conference, namely anthropological legacies and human futures, are, amongst others, how can the human condition today be read through these concepts and empirical realities? What are the questions that need to be asked now? And do the shifts in anthropological theorizing of kinship and gender reflect historical changes? And if so, how? Our first speaker on some of these topics, who should be known to all of you, is Janet Carsten, who is Professor of Social and Cultural Anthropology at the University of Edinburgh, and who has engaged with and contributed substantially to the anthropology of the house, of relatedness in many of its forms, and of kinship for many years. And since I'm going to keep this short, I'll just mention one of your books, namely a book that many of you would be familiar with and have engaged with, namely After Kinship from 2004. So I give the floor to you, Janet. Very pleased to have you here.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Thomas, and thank you especially for the invitation to speak on this theme. As some of you probably know, we in the UK are very grateful to know that we still have friends in Europe, and I suspect that we're going to be even more grateful in the years to come. So the conference theme of anthropological legacies and human futures is a particularly apt one for considering contemporary articulations of kinship and gender. Kinship has, of course, been central to anthropology, as Thomas has just said, since its very beginnings in the 19th century, although for some people it has perhaps recently not appeared to be the most happening area of our discipline. To judge by the panels and papers in this conference, kinship studies are thriving, and we're still finding plenty of new things to say. The importance to gender of gender to anthropology, which became widely recognized from the 1970s, might have been expected to eclipse kinship. Somehow, this hasn't happened. But the study of kinship has been profoundly affected by the recognition of the centrality of gender and by the insights of feminist scholarship. My paper looks at these developments together, considering why kinship continues to be central to our discipline and in what ways the study of gender has been transformational. I reflect on how these two areas shape each other, and beyond this, why they are likely to remain part of our toolkit and our theoretical insights for the future. Integral to the very beginnings of kinship studies was the idea that how we classify our world shapes behavior. Kinship categories, accessible through terminology, governed, it was supposed, such things as who one was permitted to marry, who had to be avoided, and whom to respect. The disputed relation between categories and behaviour and which has priority is still a contested issue, and we might see this as part of a broader discussion of the relation between abstraction and practices. Do symbols which are abstracted from the things they symbolise generate practices, or is it practices that give rise to symbols? Partly because kinship and gender encompass everyday practice and symbols heavy with moral connotations, houses and hearths, blood and soil, the gendered body, they are at the heart of these core anthropological concerns. But the study of kinship and gender also places us in the midst of a kind of everyday anthropology in which we might say all human beings engage. Domestic practices deal with material stuff, food, clothing, buildings, furnishings, and decorations, and their many elaborations. They are also a key domain of moral and ethical observations and prescriptions. Woven through understandings of kinship is the often unremarked imaginative work to grasp how our parents and grandparents, as well as more distant forebears, lived their lives in the past, and how our children and grandchildren will shape theirs in the future. Kinship, in other words, is shot through with temporality and analogy, the capacity to construct chains of connections into the past and future, to memorialise and to forget, to imagine and to ignore connections, to build correspondences and to deny them. This construction and comparison are part of what it means to be human. It should go without saying, although often it does not, that kinship therefore also underlies processes of exclusion and erasure. And we've all read many rather sentimentalized academic versions of anthropology, including a recent one by Marshall Sahlins. We might see gender as enfolded within these simultaneously practical, symbolic, and imaginative processes of kinship. We could equally say that relatedness is already shaped by constructions of gender. Both positions rest on the insights of feminist scholarship over the last several decades. The degree to which anthropological groundings have shifted over this period is illuminated by Marilyn Strathern's recently published Before and After Gender, a work originally written in the early 1970s, but only now seeing the light of day. Reading this constitutes a peculiar kind of time travel, simultaneously evoking anthropological legacies and futures, but also prompting speculation about a counterfactual disciplinary chronology. Inevitably, one wonders, had this book appeared at the time it was written, how might things have proceeded differently? Before and After Gender prefigures at least four major concerns that Strathern continued to develop in her later work: relationality, personhood, law, and naturalization. Together, these encompass much of what has been innovative in studies of gender and kinship over the last several decades, and what continues to preoccupy us. In rendering gender as relationality, Strathern underlines in numerous ways how gender inscribes, models, or inserts itself into other forms of relation. Partly through the way gender can stand for opposition and complementarity, she shows how it is boundlessly generative of other relations, but also encompassing. The attentiveness to naturalization, together with relationality, illuminates how difficult it is to escape our own cultural versions of gender relations and our ideas of what constitutes the person, because they're so deeply embedded in many facets of our own cultural history. Laying out descriptions of patriarchy or calling for an end to unequal gender relations, Strathern argued, was unlikely to be adequate to the task of political change. So this early lost book was, or is, at once a prescient commentary on contemporary 1970s feminist writing and also a pioneering work in the anthropology of gender. Rather than focusing on relationality, personhood, law, and naturalization singly, it's the continuous intertwining of these themes that I think has been and will continue to be intellectually productive. So in the remaining part of this presentation, I'm going to pick just a few instances to show how taking two or more of these themes together, delineating how they seep into each other, continues to take us down some innovative paths. So, start with relationality and personhood. The theme of relationality might be expected to lead straight to the classic terrain in anthropology that deals in relationships, kinship. What does relationality change, or how does it add to kinship? First, relationality does not presuppose that relations are understood by those that engage in them to have their basis in familial, procreative, or final ties. So relationality incorporates a wider field than kinship, and it's hard to see how it could fail to incorporate gender directly or indirectly. Relationality can thus encompass kinship, but as I will elaborate in a moment, it may also be encompassed by kinship. Second, relationality suggests we should also be concerned with the entities that participate in relating, and these include, although they are not limited to, persons. We need to attend to how persons or other entities that are doing the relating are constructed in particular cultural or historical contexts. This is also generally the case, of course, in the study of kinship, but one might argue that it's not necessarily so. Anthropological interest in personhood, which of course has a very long history, came to new prominence at roughly the same time as studies of gender. Tellingly, however, the book The Category of the Person, edited by Carithers, Collins and Lukes, which was published in 1985, a volume that did much to bring this area to anthropological attention, has no entry for gender in its index. How much has changed since then? Let's jump forward a few decades. Aaron Goodfellow's Gay Fathers, Their Children and the Making of Kinship, published in 2015, is in more than one sense, I think, a kinship study for our times. Gay men creating families could hardly have been envisaged as a subject for anthropological study in the 1970s, but this is not a work that simply suggests that the place of kinship has been supplanted by an expanded notion of the self, or that unconstrained choice and personhood have free reign in the contemporary US, where, as if in some fantasy Californian commune, anything goes. On the contrary, Goodfellow brings together affect, law, and sexuality to show how gay fathers are both circumscribed in their actions and ethics by institutions and norms surrounding the family and sexuality, and how they also push at the boundaries of these in their attempts to make new families. The fathers he portrays may seek to live near their extended biological kin, reasoning that this will provide important succor and support for their families, but in so doing, subscribing to prevailing values. They hire lawyers to help navigate and overcome the difficulties they face in adopting children, and many of them seem to play out conventional suburban versions of the American family. But the experiences that Goodfellow draws out reveal in stark contours the precariousness and fragility of kinship that exists in tension with prevailing and historical norms and is simultaneously encompassed by them. The sharp disjunctures between moments of comfortable middle-class family life and their abrupt unraveling precipitated by some momentary glance, word, or gesture shows this to be a kinship that is far from providing a safe haven. While law has a prescriptive force, and I'll return to this in a moment, it can be mitigated through experience. Goodfellow foregrounds the visions and practices of affect, care, and relationality through which state laws and institutional prescriptions are lived. The provisionality and uncertainties of kinship are clarified through processes of time. Outcomes can only be known in the future or retrospectively discovered. So the next little bit is about naturalization. Relationality, gender, law, and personhood are inextricably connected. To my mind, the insertion in this nexus of naturalization as a kind of meta-process, since it encompasses all of these themes, profoundly affects how we study kinship and gender. Naturalization was put on the agenda for many of us by Carol McCormack and Marilyn Strathern's edited volume, Nature, Culture, and Gender, published in 1980. That groundbreaking volume laid out the intricate connections among ideas about procreation, nature, and gender, and their importance for wider symbolic systems. Insights that have remained fundamental ever since. Naturalization illuminates, too, the contributions of kinship and gender to the way hierarchy and exclusion are embedded in conceptual schemes and in practical relations. Processes of naturalization may be elaborated from and also model relations between persons, but they commonly also refer to material substances and objects. Bodily matter, land and soil are often part of such symbolic chains of connection. My own recent work examining symbolic and practical articulations of blood across a number of connected fields and sites in Malaysia, medical, laboratory, bodily, moral, familial, and donation, was designed to tease apart the ways in which blood moves with ease between different domains, but also to consider what is transported along with it. What, in other words, makes blood such an apt symbol of kinship, ethnos, race, nation, and sacrifice? My starting premise was that the very obviousness of these bloody connections and their deep historical embeddedness in specific cultural matrices, their simultaneous ubiquity and particularity, makes it particularly difficult to discern how exactly blood operates as a powerful, emotive, and highly plastic symbol. At the beginning of this project, one skeptic disarmingly asked, "How can you study something for which we don't have a body of theoretical work on which to build?" The response might be, "How come we don't have this?" But work on naturalization can certainly point the way. One obvious aspect of blood is its aptness for gendered symbolism, and this indeed is prominent in some of the earlier literature on blood. My own preoccupation in the symbolics of blood has been less directly with gender than with its capacity to stand for kinship, race, and nation, gender, of course, in themselves. Taking a quite literal approach to the investigation of blood through the study of clinical pathology labs, donation sites, and blood banks in Malaysia has allowed me to build up a picture of what happens when it moves from human bodies to these locations, and how donors and medical lab technologists and other clinical staff interact with and through blood. I don't have time to give you this ethnography here, but what's very striking is the ease with which different understandings of blood can be attached to a blood sample or to a donation as it moves around a lab or blood bank. These are mainly quite imperceptible moves articulated in small and seemingly trivial actions or comments by staff or donors. What they reveal is the deeply layered quality of the symbolism of blood and the processes of naturalization on which it rests. We can see how naturalization, like a process of sedimentation, incorporates qualities of materiality and temporality. It involves the implicit accretion of ideas and connections that have their origins in different epochs and different locations. So a blood sample in a test tube may carry traces of ethnicity, race, and kinship. It may initiate conversations about diagnostics, kinship, or sexuality, or about Ayurvedic or Chinese medicine. Blood as material substance is implicitly relational and on many axes, as it were. None of this is exactly obvious when we see blood, but we can begin to grasp not just the emotional power of evocations of blood, but also the hidden characteristics of the way such symbolism operates. The responses that references to blood elicit may thus seem overwhelmingly predetermined. Close examination of what happens to samples in a test tube in an uncontroversial and apparently unpoliticized site allows us to build a bigger picture of the salience of blood and of the multiple and unbounded connections among medicine, kinship, ethnicity, and politics. We can begin to follow, in other words, processes of naturalization in action. So, moving on to law. One of the themes in Strathern's Before and After Gender that I've already mentioned is law. This has been prominent in Strathern's work, but also in other recent studies of kinship. As new legal enactments have had to keep pace with technological innovations and with changing ideas and practices of family life, law has been an important aspect of research on reproductive medicine and kinship. The variations in regulations, for example, within Europe and their cultural implications, have been well documented in part by my distinguished colleague on the same panel. While laws governing reproduction, marriage, and property rights within marriage can be historically understood in terms of the imposition of patriarchal and heteronormative family ideals by the state, recent changes, such as the referendum in favour of legalising gay marriage in Ireland last year, challenge and complicate such a view. Erin Goodfellow's study of gay fathers, to which I've already referred, is concerned with how the legal frameworks governing adoption in the US and internationally permeate the experiences of his research participants. He also touches on the tensions between competing ideas about marriage in the political struggles over the recognition of gay marriage, the respective resonances of marriage and civil union, and the terms that gay men use to refer to their partners. So these are quite different domains of life. While the political right has defined marriage as, I quote, a religious, cultural, and natural union between a man and a woman, end of quote, the men depicted in Goodfellow's study have no simple unitary position on marriage versus civil union. On the contrary, he shows, I quote, how fatherhood for gay men exceeds and transfigures while remaining embedded within the parameters of the law and the organizing grammar of the heterosexual family, end of quote. So his research participants could opt for civil union before the legalization of same-sex marriage in the US and distance themselves from the history and connotations of legal marriage. Yet at the same time, they might refer to their partners as husband and to themselves as married. Doing so is not simply an ironic gesture, but as Goodfellow carefully shows, also a way of doing kinship, participating creatively in its flexible and shifting meanings, and indicating, as he puts it, how queer family relations touch, but also introduce a fissure in established definitions of kin terms. It is also, he suggests, a way of dealing with the uncertainties, illegibility, and unintelligibility that accompanies the formation of queer families. Law is thus an expression of state interventions and prescriptions around marriage, but as Goodfellow's study underlines, we need to beware of overstating its prescriptive force. This is equally the case if we turn to another highly topical area for examining the intersections of kinship, gender, and the state, that of the legal circumscriptions governing migration. Catherine Lee's fictive kinship, family reunification, and the meaning of race and nation in American immigration examines the history of immigration law in the US from the beginning of the 20th century and the centrality of ideas about the family to changes in this legislation. Once again, we see how law connects to naturalization. Because the policies of family reunification have been pivotal to immigration policies, Lee is able to show how normative ideas about the family have been instrumental in defining who was allowed to enter the United States and who was excluded. But those in favor of liberalizing immigration and those who sought to curtail it have drawn on ideologically driven versions of what constitutes the family and its importance to the nation. In the context of immigration policies, it's not surprising to learn that the ideas about the family that were brought into play in the US were strongly gendered and racialized. They rested on an ideology of racial hierarchy and purity, rendered through idioms of blood, and on endogamy between those of the same origins. Family reunion might seem a relatively benign frame for immigration policy, but in the context of gendered and racialized versions of the family, in which different origins are deemed to result in different versions of the family, and different categories of relation and person count for more or less, such policies have exclusionary effects, as Lee's study powerfully demonstrates. We might want to learn more, however, about how exactly familial idioms are naturalized here and woven into the idea of the nation. Of course, naturalization is itself a suggestively loaded term in the context of immigration. Goodfellow's observations on gay fatherhood suggest that an exploration of the lived experience of these exclusions would reveal some subtle and flexible responses of affect and care in what he calls the fissures of kinship. Okay, a little word on marriage. Productive insights about the importance of everyday practices and experiences are fundamental to any anthropological understanding of the way people live within and at times beyond or at the edges of the law. In forthcoming collaborative research on new transformations of marriage funded by the EU, I'll be exploring the way that legal changes surrounding marriage may both be a response to wider shifts in perceptions about normative gender relations and also themselves an engine for social transformation. Anthropologists and sociologists are used to seeing marriage in conservative terms as reflecting and preserving a patriarchal and heteronormative status quo. But what happens if we turn this assumption on its head and instead take seriously its transformative potential? This new project will investigate contemporary forms of marriage emerging in five quite different contexts: marriage under conditions of economic austerity in Greece, gay marriage in a strongly Christian fundamentalist area of the US, marriage as it transforms in the HIV/AIDS pandemic in Botswana, marriage and migration between contrastive politico-economic regimes in Taiwan and China, and new forms of middle-class marriage or non-marriage in urban Malaysia and Singapore. The work will be attentive both to the ways marriage is affected by unfolding legal, political, and economic conditions, and to how it catalyzes wider social change. Law is, of course, not the only point of interest for such a study. It's hard to imagine a new comparative focus on marriage that would not build on the insights of feminist scholarship over the last several decades. Indeed, a recuperation of the comparative anthropology of marriage for the new kinship studies underlines the vision for this research. An examination of relations of care, changing ritual forms, and property in an unstable world will constitute three strands to this work and will encourage the consideration of marriage in the broadest possible terms. The organization of marriage, like migration, is one obvious arena for planning the future, as well as comparing one's own relationships with those of one's forebears. It is thus inherently a comparative, affective, and imaginative process embedded in temporality. The more abstract theme of temporality, alluding to the entwined practices and affects enfolded in marriage and their temporal situatedness, will provide an avenue for theorizing kinship as social imaginary. Okay, I've just got a short conclusion. I've touched at different points in this presentation on the salience of kinship and gender to migration. As we observe contemporary global population upheavals and the xenophobic tendencies that have been unleashed across Europe and elsewhere, migration and the dislocations that motivate it and which it sets in train should be much on our minds. The exclusions we're witnessing may seem less about kinship than about warfare, economics, and the politics of fear. But I suspect that for those experiencing these upheavals, kinship may matter as much as almost anything. For better or for worse, kinship and gender will be with us in the anthropological future. This is partly because of the importance of everyday lived experience, everyday lived relationships in people's lives, but also through imaginative worlds, which are peopled with forebears and descendants, metaphorical and real. Lives and futures are made and unmade in and through kinship, as Goodfellow puts it. We should mention, too, houses, food, photographs, and other material artifacts that may be attached to kinship as sources of sustenance, care, comfort, and pleasure, or of loss, discomfort, and sorrow. The idea that modernity is somehow after kinship is, of course, a myth, as MacKinnon and McCannell have trenchantly argued very recently. On the contrary, kinship is everywhere, and particularly in the places we are encouraged not to see it. Naturalization, I've argued, is fundamental to the embedding of inequalities and exclusions, most saliently for us today, in those that underlie the political rhetoric and legal enactments that enforce the borders of nation states and appeal to the emotions of their citizens. It is through careful attentiveness to gender and kinship and to material substances and objects that embody relational and temporal qualities that we can come to understand these processes better. Kinship is a terrain that often seems overburdened with legacies, both for anthropologists and for those whose lives we study. But I've tried to show why we can expect it to continue to yield up new and productive insights. Keeping gender and kinship together in view, we are unlikely to exhaust the questions they inspire or their analytic and ethnographic possibilities. The relational qualities of each imply, as Strathern presciently showed back in the 1970s, that in a kaleidoscopic or prism-like way, they are fundamental and generative, not just to ideas or practices of intimacy, but to the way we categorize and imagine our worlds, to rules and legislations that uphold their borders and boundaries, to symbolizing processes, in other words, to every aspect of life.
So thanks very much, Janet. The next speaker on this panel is Professor Marit Melhuus at the Department of Social Anthropology at the University of Oslo. Although Marit was for years known mainly for her work in Latin America, not least on gender, but also on politics, power, and the economy, she's more recently focused on the meanings of kinship in contemporary Norway, and the implications of reproductive technologies on kinship and legislation. And I will just briefly mention the title of her book dealing with this subject, namely Problems of Conception, Issues of Law, Biotechnology, Individuals and Kinship, 2012. So, Marit, over to you.
Thank you. First, I want to thank Thomas for organizing this timely panel. Is this on? Yes? Yeah, now it's on. For organizing this timely panel on kinship and gender. This is a topic that definitely merits attention. Anthropologists may agree that kinship and gender have been central to anthropological concerns, but it is not obvious that these analytical concepts, whether separately or together, will continue to be so. So although there is a prominent, albeit shifting, legacy to be acknowledged, the future trajectory of kinship and gender will necessarily depend on the force of their explanatory power. What phenomena, which processes, at what scales can be fruitfully addressed by being attentive to kinship and gender? This is not just an empirical question, it is also a matter of where we choose to direct our anthropological gaze. I also want to thank you, Thomas, for inviting me to be part of this panel. Being here today brings to mind the very first EASA conference, called Anthropology in Europe, held in Coimbra in 90. At that conference, Teresa del Valle, one of the founding members of EASA, convened a panel on constructing genders, where Signe Howell and I presented a paper entitled The Study of Kinship, The Study of Person, A Study of Gender. Much water has run under the bridge since then, and my framing today is quite different from what it was then. Those of you who were present at that conference might also recall a rather heated and very lively debate during the General Assembly on the politics of gender and its relevance for EASA. and I won't mention the names. In what follows, I will reflect on some current instances of the mutual entanglement and transformative capacities of both kinship and gender. My overall focus is on the state and how state regulations inflect gender and kinship. My empirical examples are taken from Norway. More specifically, I focus on sperm and eggs. As human materials, sperm and eggs are potentially creative of other human beings. As procreative substances, they are especially evocative because they encompass ideas that draw their force from nature or the natural. At least this is the case in Norway. As such, these materials are facts of life, but these are not stable facts. The nature of the facts are susceptible to political rhetorical challenges, thus shifting the very ground from which their potentials are drawn. These entities are not only artifacts of a legal procedure, but also draw their connotations from spheres external to a legislative process. I frame my discussion through what Lambeck terms as state-produced or state-authorized acts of kinship and the grounds upon which such authorizations are drawn. Not only is the state involved in acts of kinship, but the state also comes to play a significant role in the very production and reproduction of kinship. Insofar as kinship and gender are mutually constitutive, gender is also implicated in such kinship acts. However, the ways in which kinship and gender work, together or separately, will vary. There may be a certain tension at a discursive level in the performative thrust of these two dimensions, where figure and ground shift depending on context and not least positioning. One evident site where such state-authorized acts of kinship can be localized is in law or legislative processes, especially those laws that have to do directly or indirectly with acts of procreation and birth, such as those concerned with marriage, issuing birth certificates, and citizenship, naming and inheritance laws, and laws that establish paternity and maternity. Such issues are often regulated through different legislations, which impinge on each other, but are not all of one piece. Yet ideally, they should, of course, cohere. Kinship, then, is regulated by various acts, which in different ways identify persons and relations. The legal regulation that concerns me here is the Norwegian Biotechnology Act. It regulates, among other things, who is to have access to assisted conception, what forms of assistance are permitted, and which technologies are appropriate. Although the Act itself is not framed in terms of kinship, it engages directly with vital matters instrumental to producing persons and relationships. Many of the practices it regulates authorizes the means by which people can procreate and can be related. Through these regulations, sperm and eggs and wombs have become subjects of law, reflecting shifting political concerns regarding procreation, marriage, parenthood, and gender, in effect, kinship and filiation. This legislation has been the continued focus of a contested biopolitics, revisions occurring more or less with a shift in government. Such revisions are revealing of the underlying values and sociocultural processes that are mobilized to move the law and express the public appeal such values may have. The Norwegian Biotechnology Act is currently under evaluation, thus very contemporary. One of the contested issues is whether egg donation is to be permitted in Norway. Egg donation has been prohibited ever since the first law regulating assisted conception in Norway was passed in 1987. Although there have over the years been prominent voices arguing for permitting egg donation, they have not won sufficient support to sway the vote in Parliament. This situation has, however, markedly changed. And this change has fundamentally to do with a significant discursive shift regarding the properties of sperm and eggs. Whereas the dominant discourse regarding egg and sperm donation, which is allowed in Norway, albeit with a known donor, has been grounded in a differential treatment of egg and sperm, ascribed to the natural differences between men and women, This position over the past years has been challenged by an egalitarian principle of human rights and of equality. The central argument here is that male and female sex cells have the same ethical value, and moreover, that the prohibition on egg donation is a biased discrimination between infertile men and infertile women. Although such arguments were raised publicly already in 2003, they did not have any significant impact on the revision of the law at that time. It is, as detachable body parts, virtually free to circulate independently of any whole body, that the different qualities of sperm and eggs have been made explicit. What draws my attention are the ways in which these parts are related to the wholes from which they may be potentially detached, and not least the way the whole, in this case, male and female reproductive bodies, are differently apprehended. In fact, by declaring that egg and sperm have the same ethical value, while at the same time framing the prohibition on egg donation in terms of gender discrimination, certain differences between men and women, maternity and paternity, that earlier have been crucial, are effectively undermined. The most telling example of this discursive shift is the majority statement on egg donation made in 2011 by the Norwegian Biotechnology Advisory Board to the Ministry of Health. In the summary of this statement, the majority declare that, and I quote, they wish that men and women, sperm and egg cells, should be treated as similarly as possible in the law. And they continue, and I quote again, the majority does not find it more problematic that egg donation introduces a distinction between genetic and biological social mother than that the use of sperm donation already has established a distinction between biological and social father. The majority, therefore, does not find that there are good enough reasons to maintain the prohibition on egg donation. And this same board upheld this position in 2015. By explicitly iterating an equality argument between men and women and sperm and eggs, this declaration represents a significant move towards a possible change of the regulation on egg donation in Norway. And three points are central. The equality argument, making men and women and sperm and eggs the same in one aspect, namely their genetic properties. Two, a rejection of earlier arguments that privilege motherhood as unique. And three, the insistence on the significance of the genetic properties of both egg and sperm, rendering the reproductive distinction between social and biological parenthood the same for men and women. This shift in the public discourse articulates a processual displacement of the reproductive horizons of men and women, and this displacement converges on a renegotiation of the cultural value placed on sperm and eggs. It's my contention. Fundamentally, what is at stake are notions of maternity and paternity and filiation. And as de Thurn has pointed out, the different kinds of proof needed to establish the fact of procreation in pre-technology Euro-American systems. Motherhood was established through birth, and fatherhood through presumed coitus with mother. Hence, motherhood is always certain, but fatherhood is not. So let me now turn to the arguments against egg donation, very briefly. I here condense a set of arguments that have been reiterated over time in public documents, legal debates, and the media. These have often been framed in conjunction with sperm donation and turn on the difference between men and women's reproductive functions. Whereas sperm donation is considered as an extension of natural reproduction, egg donation is seen as a radical interference of the same. The fact that sperm is available outside the body is a point often made, underscoring that this form of detachment implies ipso facto paternal uncertainty and a potential discrepancy between legal and social paternity. Thus, or biological paternity. Thus, sperm donation is no different from that which occurs naturally. However, eggs are situated differently. Their availability is limited in terms of quantity and access. They are seen as intrinsic to the natural whole of which they are a part. This is framed in terms of a unified process from conception through gestation and birth, which was, and still is by some, seen as inviolable. Egg donation would upset natural reproduction, as the uterus and egg constitute a natural unity. Conception, pregnancy, and birth were seen as a unified process, constituting what was termed as a unified motherhood. Introducing a foreign egg would not only destroy this natural unity, but also undermine the most fundamental of human emotions, the natural feeling of mother belonging, morstillhörighet. In splitting this unity, egg donation would cause insecurity regarding who the mother really is, and hence threaten the identity of the child. One statement made by a former Member of Parliament sums up this position very nicely, and I quote, "It is wrong that the mother of the child should be unknown. The belonging to mother is inviolable. For me, it is not a question of gender equality, but respect for the order of nature," unquote. Paradoxically, the use of a donated egg, implying the introduction of a strange or an unknown mother, simultaneously acknowledges the salience of the egg in constituting motherhood. Legally, the issue of egg donation was resolved by two moves. A provision was added to the Biotechnology Act stating that fertilized eggs can only be inserted into the woman from whom the egg cells originate. Moreover, and as a consequence of the reproductive technologies, Norway in 1997 added an amendment to the Children's Act defining the mother as the one who gives birth. Until then, it was deemed unnecessary to have any explicit definition, legal definition, of mother, as this was seen as obvious. Although eggs may potentially be detached and used in vitro fertilization, they may not circulate between women. Moreover, maternity was ascribed to the woman who gives birth. This definition precludes surrogacy. In 2003, Norway repealed its anonymity clause with regard to sperm donation and prescribed the use of known donor. The decision was based on a child's right to know its biogenetic origin, as this is fundamental to a child's identity and hence seen as a right. A donor register was established, ensuring that the knowledge of the real father is lodged with the state and made available on demand from the child at the age of 18. Through donor disclosure, sperm is not only granted the property of identifying the real father, it is also reattached to its source, as it were. It is restored to its proper natural biological relation, mediating a relationship which in fact had already always been there, the uncertainty of fatherhood. From the perspective of the state, it is a matter of getting these facts right, and thus be able to establish and distinguish between the biological and the social legal father. This is done in the best interest of the child. However, for the child, this knowledge is conditional, as the parents are not obliged to reveal the facts of conception. So we have a situation where there is a public state knowledge of a kinship relation, but not necessarily a personal knowledge of the same. We could say that there is a legal fabrication of a certain filiation based on a natural fact, but this fact may not necessarily materialize for those involved. The rescinding of donor anonymity is fundamental insofar as it is a claim about the significance attributed to genetics in establishing filiation and identity. However, the conflation of facts and values is at the same time nothing more than a legal potential insofar as disclosure remains the parent's discretion. Facts are dependent upon acts. So what about egg donation? Whereas a child de facto can have two fathers, it can only have one mother. The distinction between social, legal, and biological genetic is not made relevant. And I am in this context not considering adoption. But also on this count, the law is not unequivocal. Norwegian couples in need of an egg travel to clinics abroad where such treatments are offered. If conception and pregnancy are achieved, the woman will eventually give birth to a child. According to Norwegian law, she will be registered as the child's mother. The origin of the egg is effectively erased, even rendered irrelevant. Thus, the value of the unitary motherhood is upheld as a legal fiction. If the legal regulations have been driven by a need to establish some kind of certainty in the wake of the potential fragmentation of motherhood, actual practices undermine these efforts. This also holds true for women or couples who prefer to use anonymous sperm. In 2008, Norway passed a gender-neutral marriage act. This act grants same-sex and heterosexual couples the same rights, also with regard to assisted conception. Here, another bias in reproductive practices emerges. Whereas lesbian couples are granted infertility treatment, sperm donation, within the public health system, male homosexual couples are not, as Norwegian law does not permit surrogacy arrangements. Hence, many of these couples enter cross-border surrogacy. Surrogacy further visualizes the fragmentation of motherhood and is perceived by some as the ultimate commodification of reproduction. However, surrogacy also evinces an interesting difference in the perceived attributes of sperm and eggs, making amply evident some implications of the differential treatment of sperm and eggs for men and women. Cross-border surrogacy has become an option for many couples in Norway, but in particular for homosexual couples. This is due, then, to the Norwegian paternity laws. A man may enter a surrogate contract and obtain legal fatherhood by acknowledging his paternity and or also by providing proof through a DNA test. As Norwegian citizenship is based primarily on jus sanguis, the child will be granted Norwegian citizenship insofar as the father is Norwegian and thus be able to enter the Kingdom of Norway. A woman entering a surrogacy contract, despite having used her own eggs, has no way to claim the child as hers. Her eggs do not count. The only legal way to transfer motherhood is by adoption. So also in these cases, we see the implications of the differential treatment of sperm and eggs. Fatherhood is established on different criteria than is motherhood. The proofs required are of a different order. Let me now return to my point of departure, the mutual entanglement of kinship and gender. Through examining legislative processes as state-authorized acts of kinship, what we see is that the questions of gender and gender equality and acts regulating procreation do not necessarily work in tandem. One effort on the part of the state in its confrontation with reproductive technologies is an attempt to stabilize kinship through the various provisions in the Biotechnology Act. As we have seen, these efforts are thwarted as in that persons and couples will do what they deem best for them, irrespective of the law. Another point has been to indicate a shift in the discursive formations that have underpinned the legal regulations, and hence pointing to possible reformulations. These have to do with the differential treatment of sperm and eggs as subjects of inegalitarian practices. Whereas eggs are inalienable, sperm is exchangeable. In terms of their biogenetic contributions to the human embryo, there is an equivalence between sperm and eggs. One could imagine that they are seen as having the same constitutive role in creating persons and identities, and in a certain sense they are. Yet, this same constitutive property does not necessarily translate into an equal treatment of sperm and eggs. It is therefore noteworthy that those who put forth arguments to legalize egg donation do so in terms of equality. Whereas sperm and eggs were earlier configured as different by nature, they are now recognized as equal in one essential natural factual aspect. They each contribute equally to the creation of the embryo, and by implication, I presume, they have the same ethical value. Consequently, motherhood and fatherhood are placed on the same plane. Maternity is not privileged as something more and or different than paternity. Thus, a child may have two mothers, and this is no different from a child having a genetic and social legal father. Moreover, when this argument is conjoined with one that points to a biased discrimination of infertile men and infertile women, a totally different agenda is brought to the table. Natural differences between men and women and sperm and eggs have been subsumed, if not supplanted, in order to frame a totally different argument, which may be difficult to refute. Arguments that hinge on equality, and more specifically on gender equality, have good purchase in Norway. Until now, eggs have been the discursive glue of a unitary motherhood. To reconfigure eggs has demanded a different discursive formation, one based on equality and discrimination. It remains to be seen if such values will override those that are grounded in ideas of the natural. Nevertheless, what is apparent is that regulations pertaining to gender, equality, and those pertaining to acts of procreation do not, as I have mentioned, necessarily work in tandem. So I'm going to end with one final twist to the configuration of gender and kinship, and the authorization of kinship acts through legal regulations. Only this spring, the Norwegian government has proposed a law regarding legal gender recognition and the changing of legal gender. This new law grants any person over the age of 16 the right to self-declare his or her legal gender. Moreover, the proposal also allows that such a declaration be reversible. Self-declaration implies that no other proof, medical or otherwise, of a person's gender identity is needed. The decision is yours to make. All you need to do is fill in a form. However, this law also impinges on the Biotechnology Act, and the suggested amendments are worth noting. First of all gendered terms have been substituted with gender-neutral terms, such as person, and I'll give one example. Fertilized eggs cannot be inserted into the uterus of another person, before it was women, than the one from whom the egg cells originated. But more significantly is paragraph 2.1, which concerns cases of assisted conception granted to persons who have changed their legal gender. In these cases, it is the person's, and this is the term used in the law text, bodily gender that forms the basis for the decision to initiate treatment. This is at least my reading of that text. In other words, a person with a female body who has changed her legal gender to male will be granted assisted conception as if she were a woman. It is his gendered body that determines the access to treatment. Thus, we have a totally new situation where a male person with a female body becomes mother to a child through giving birth while being legally its father. This situation brings to mind the title of Edith Clark's monograph from 1957 on Jamaican family systems, My Mother Who Fathered Me, and is yet an example of what Bob Simpson has coined as scrambling parenthood, and an example of the contemporary articulation of kinship and gender. Thank you.
Great, thanks very much, Marit. So our third and final speaker on this panel is Miguel Vale de Almeida, who's a professor at the Instituto Superior de Ciencias do Trabajo e da Empresa in Lisbon. He's also the current editor-in-chief of the journal Etnografica. And keeping this short, I should also add that Miguel is also involved in gender activism in Lisbon, and among his many books in English is The Hegemonic Male, Masculinity in a Portuguese Town, from 2004. So, Miguel, thanks for being here, and the floor is yours.
Thank you. Well, just a correction. The new editor of the journal is Manuel Acuña, and she's around there somewhere.
I'm sorry about that.
We've just changed.
You should have updated the website.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, actually, I did. Well, I'll say. Okay, maybe I didn't. Well, buongiorno a tutti e a tutte. It's an honor and a responsibility to be here today, because in a European event in today's Europe, which so many of our co-Europeans are destroying happily, is obviously a situation of high responsibility, and I'm afraid that what I have to say will take us out of focus from Europe specifically, so I apologize for that. Let me start with a few words about personal and professional context. As an anthropologist, I have done research on gender and masculinity, as well as on same-sex marriage and family and other issues. I have been an LGBT rights activist for quite some time, and I was involved in the second abortion referendum of 2008 in my country, Portugal, which led to free access to abortion in the National Health Service. That was a symbolic defeat of the previous influence of the Catholic Church, because I believe that it has stopped ever since. And it also opened the path for LGBT rights discussions in the country, for the recognition of LGBT rights, while at the same time avoiding the separation that exists in some countries between women's rights agenda and LGBT rights agenda. I was also a member of the Portuguese Parliament between 2009 and 2011, and I drafted the same-sex marriage law, which was passed, as well as a gender identity law, similar to the one that Marit just talked about. And all the other laws after that have been done by other people, but they've had the help of some of us anthropologists. Now, why do I mention this and contextualize it this way? Because I believe that legislative debates are very good examples of a few points of concern to us anthropologists. First, that the struggle for improvement in laws unveils a politics of the symbolic. The main issue in the Portuguese discussion about equal marriage was whether same-sex marriage should be called marriage or some new word. The conservative sectors insisted on a new word for a specific configuration of same-sex conjugality. Secondly, the public debates around LGBT rights are and should be closely connected to wider discussions on gender. Third, the term that the terms in which debates are focused tend to focus on what used to be anthropological old themes about nature versus culture and so on. Things that we have surpassed and overcome, they actually obviously continue in everyday societal debates. Whether through rhetorics of religion or biology or natural law, the fact is that the gender binary and reproduction, mainly the control of women's reproductive rights, either by banning abortion or by not allowing certain categories of women to access medically assisted reproduction, anxieties around children, especially their personality development, if raised by gay or lesbian couples, and so on and so forth, are all issues that call to our attention and participation in societal debates. Usually, however, these debates occur at the level of the nation states, and that is why they are metaphorical of the anxieties about the nation as a gendered and sexualized sort of extended family. Anthropological discussions about kinship, marriage, reproduction, gender, family, and so on are crucial in these debates. But we tend to overlook another traditional area of anthropological focus, which is that of cultural and social diversity and relativity and comparison. And the power relations between culturally and historically constituted polities in long colonial and imperial as well as post-colonial histories. That is what I would like to focus on here today, taking the global as the scale of observation and the figure of the LGBT person as the focal point of global culture wars. And that's why we decided to change the sequence of our talks. And my colleagues suggested that because I'm going to the global, which is always a tricky field to step on. The recognition of LGBT rights in the 21st century is increasingly portrayed as a symbol and a measure of progress. I will use a lot of this, but I really have to, because the categories that I address that way are very complicated. So the recognition of LGBT rights in the 21st century is increasingly portrayed as a symbol and a measure of progress and of the implementation of universal human rights. A country is seen as being either in the avant-garde or on the rear end of that progress, as the sheer existence of rights rankings attests. Everyone's always doing rankings about how much or less LGBT rights are respected.
Simultaneously, reactions to the current geopolitics and to national identity tensions have been highlighting the LGBT person as a pariah in a kind of reactive homophobia, a form of backlash that is not dissimilar to that which has been afflicting feminism. This is challenging, very challenging for us. I certainly do, we do want advancement in LGBT human rights, but we are also aware of the dangers of Eurocentric narratives of progress. And this is the contradiction that is imminent to being an anthropologist and an activist. Let me elaborate. In 2009, a workshop took place in Kampala, the capital of Uganda. It was called Seminar on Exposing the Homosexual's Agenda, and it was organized by a certain family life network. Among the invited speakers were three evangelical Christian leaders from the US. One was a self-defined ex-gay man, whatever that is, another the author of books against homosexuality, and yet another a leader of Exodus International, an organization that proposes the liberation from homosexuality through Jesus Christ. Just 1 month later, we witnessed the event of the infamous publication in a local newspaper in Kampala of the names of people who are suspect of homosexuality. A few months thereafter, another newspaper published the list of 100 lesbian and gay men, including their photos and their home addresses. The title of the piece on the front page was "Hang Them." Just a few years later, in 2013, the Ugandan parliament passed the Kill the Gays Bill, which the Constitutional Court was to downturn, and with a lot of pressure from the Commonwealth and other international institutions, based on procedural reasons. Whether with imprisonment up to 14 years, life sentence or death penalty, homosexuality is illegal in many, but not all, and that's important, sub-Saharan African countries since the times of colonial administration. In cases such as Uganda, colonial laws were actually made more drastic, including the death penalty and its specification for cases of suspected transmission of HIV through homosexual relations. One of the speakers at the Kampala meeting of 2009 was Scott Lively. He's the author of a very interesting book called, called The Pink Swastika, a book that claims that Nazism was invented by homosexuals and that they were instrumental in making the Holocaust possible. So you see all sorts of narratives cross here, namely anti-Semitism and homophobia. Now, the history of evangelical and other Christian denominations in Africa is obviously very complex and more sophisticated. Some supported national liberation and anti-colonial movements, while others have attacked post-independence leaders as atheists and communists. So there's a variety there. Many post-colonial leaders, simultaneously educated in Protestant or Catholic missions, actually, they joined the liberation movements inspired by socialist ideals, and they are often the same who, once in power, have supported homophobic policies and law. So there's no like logical connection between being this and being that, and that's something we anthropologists know and should show how it works. Now, whether in Uganda, which I'm using here just as an example, or in some other African contexts, the alliance between post-colonial leaderships, local and international Christian movements, and the US foreign policy, especially during the Bush administration, is and has been very strong, and the persecution of homosexuality seems to be a core platform of agreement. Anti-homosexual rhetoric seems to rely on three main arguments. First, homosexuality supposedly did not exist in pre-colonial Africa, and therefore it is anti-African. Second, it was supposedly introduced by the colonizers. And third, the ex-colonizers are now supposedly conducting a pro-homosexual campaign at the global scale that needs to be countered. It seems to be irrelevant for the sake of those arguments that A, same-sex relations did exist in pre-colonial Africa, B, that it was 19th century colonialism that introduced the criminalization of homosexuality, and C, that evangelization in colonial times was in and of itself often a form of symbolic violence, something that is not acknowledged by those who, in the post-colonial situation, use Christian fundamentalist arguments to support a supposedly anti-neo-colonial policy. Charges regarding the inclusion of LGBT rights in African legal systems have been few. Regarding the inclusion of LGBT rights in African legal systems have been few. Mostly the South African case comes to mind, as well as the legalization of homosexuality in three ex-Portuguese colonies, Mozambique, Cape Verde, and São Tomé e Príncipe. And social movements are becoming increasingly active all throughout the continent, and very interesting in the way that they're doing their activism. One should not, of course, demonize Africa or engage in generalizations about the continent, or for that matter, forget the long history of the construction of representation of Africa as inherently or even hyper-heterosexual, as some works have shown. So let's look elsewhere too. If in our contemporary media-fed imagination, Uganda is like the exemplary the stronger example about the African situation, I would say that the Russian Federation, or the Russian state in this case, certainly plays that role in Eastern Europe and in the post-socialist world. The global LGBT movement and human rights organizations have highlighted attacks on LGBT people and rights in Russia. The so-called gay propaganda law was passed with the, and I'm quoting, the objective of protecting children from information that might promote the negation of traditional family values. This is a very interesting way of putting things, and we should analyze it. It was passed unanimously in the Duma, the Russian parliament, in 2013, with just one abstention. It contemplates shutting down NGOs and the imprisonment of foreign nationals, and is certainly in line with other Russian legislation that tries to curtail the action of global NGOs and their Russian counterparts as part of a policy to prevent the emergence of a Russian civil society. Not only have we become used to reports of the banning of pride parades, we have also heard statements such as the one from Moscow's mayor saying, the previous one, saying that such events are satanic, and blaming foreign organizations for spreading that kind of enlightenment in the country. Or the Ministry of Sport, or a Ministry of Sport, who equaled gay propaganda to the pushing of alcohol and drugs among young people. Reports of homophobic attacks on the streets are widespread, and that sort of violence seems to be legitimized by the state, by the fact that such laws were passed. Now, what seems to be common to these prototypical Ugandan and Russian cases? First of all, the investment in legislation and propaganda for the purposes of national differentiation and political power projects by some sectors in the state that is now focused more on sexuality and not as much as, for instance, on ethnicity or ideology. So the scapegoating seems to be shifting from ethnic or ideological issues to sexual and gender ones. The LGBT person, I will come to what I mean by the LGBT person. I really don't mean anything, but I need to be critical about the term, but I'm using it just to make it easy. The LGBT person seems to take the place of the internal enemy, the demonized other, the Jew or the sorcerer. Secondly, that other is seen as the result of an extra-national influence and one that is necessarily contrary to national values. These values are traditional. The former are dangerous cosmopolitan novelties. They originate in the West, located somewhere along the East-West antinomy or in the colonial, post-colonial one. Thirdly, confessional and religious values are collapsed in national, cultural, or ethnic ones, and vice versa. In the African case, through the post-colonial nationalization of Christian fundamentalism, which ceases to be seen as a Western colonial product, and in many Eastern European cases, through the recuperation of the role of once suppressed national churches as representatives of the authenticity of tradition and identity, formulated in terms of gender, sexuality, and family moral templates. Finally, anti-LGBT rhetoric seems to be an integral part of the discourse on the family and on the nation as a metaphorically enlarged kin group, both regulated by traditional gender assignations and controlled by heteronormativity. Children occupy a central place in this as constructed projections of innocence, victimization, and possible targets of contamination. Let us now leave Africa, and we don't have much time, and the east of Europe, and come back to the West. In a 2011 memorandum, President Obama elevated LGBT rights to a pillar of US foreign policy, instructing federal agencies with diplomatic activity to fight discrimination, homophobia, and intolerance based on LGBT status or conduct. Randy Berry, for instance, was the first Department of State special envoy for human rights of LGBT people. Actually, after the South African resolution of 2011 at the Human Rights Council of the UN, which led to the first UNHRC report, in 2014, the Council approved the resolution deploring acts of violence and discrimination in all parts of the world committed against individuals because of their sexual orientation or gender identity. And it passed with 25 votes in favor, 14 against, including Russia, Pakistan, and Saudi Arabia, and 7 abstentions. Also, the Council of the European Union drafted guidelines for the promotion and protection of all human rights by LGBTI people in a 2013 meeting. So the trend is global in Euro-American and liberal democratic contexts, as is the case of Latin America, and that in spite of the resistance of religious and conservative sectors. Actually, Brazil's declaration of 2003 was actually crucial in this, and the principles of Yogyakarta were also launched in 2007 in a meeting called by Brazil, Uruguay, and Argentina. These actions set the stage for a protagonism of Latin American and especially Southern Cone countries in the geopoliticization of LGBT rights. It is a new division, but it replicates old ones between the West and the rest, namely the West versus the Arab Islamic world and the West civilizing Africa. This division is actually replicated at the national levels in the Western liberal democracies through the religious-secular divide, as was obvious in the discussion about same-sex marriage in the supposedly exemplar case of universal and equal citizenship, France. On purpose, my reference above to the Arab-Islamic world comes late in the talk. Considering contemporary representations of the Islamic world and the continuation of Orientalist perspectives, one would expect this text to concentrate on the demonized contexts of the Arab-Islamic world for being institutionally homophobic. Like those places deserving humanitarian intervention to save women or LGBT people. These contexts appear in the Western public space as incarnations of evil, symmetrical to the pro-LGBT evil of the West, as seen by them in the Islamic countries. And this sort of mirroring of negative images is something that we really need to overcome, and I think anthropologists may help doing that. The essentializing move of portraying the Islamic world as intrinsically homophobic has as a result making it obscure, unintelligible, as if we were saying, this is who they are, they have always been like this, there's nothing we can do. Nothing more wrong, considering the differences between Arab-Islamic societies and their internal plurality. It is at the diplomatic level, at the level of representation of the states, that we can find these very harsh homophobic positions. But that applies too to the Vatican, to the Russian Federation, or to Uganda. In the West, substantial and accelerated progress in LGBT rights, and most of all the fact that LGBT rights have reached center stage in public debates about models of society, can be seen as an outcome of the agenda of individual rights that characterizes the postmodern situation, the crisis of utopian ideological projects, the triumph of neoliberal politics, and the return of religion, return, quote unquote, at a global scale, etc., etc. But in the West, debates about same-sex marriage have propitiated opportunities for new articulations by the conservative sectors, who recur to the idiom of tradition and religion, and they are opposing what they see as the decadence of society and the social order. But a decadence that is as much gender and sexuality based as it is of the economic and social model of the welfare state or of liberal democratic representation. Now, we could talk about many examples of this, But the cases of France and Poland come to mind as very interesting for our analysis. Because in both France and Poland, we saw instances of how these debates are closely connected to attacks on a new enemy that was linguistically created by conservative sectors, namely connected to the Catholic Church. And the enemy is called gender theory or gender ideology. If the Irish case, as well as the Maltese, the Argentinian, or the Brazilian, show that the advancement of LGBT rights can unfortunately be disconnected from women's rights, because in those countries abortion is forbidden, it was in France, however, that the public debate on same-sex marriage, adoption by same-sex couples, and reproductive technologies reached a peak in terms of mass mobilizations. Movements against the legal change were mobilized by an undercurrent of organized Catholic movements that support the conservative vision of French republicanism, and sexuality was the catalyst for that social movement. But it was not simply a left versus right fight. Social sciences were also involved, and they had been involved at least since the 1990 debate on the civil unions. There was a lot of structuralist resistance to the possibility of destroying the symbolic order by recognizing marriage equality. And this was the foundation of the argument of some social scientists and also psychoanalysts against marriage and family rights. And it sort of came back in the 2000s, incremented by a resistance to the paradigm of gender itself. Not just a debate in the pluralistic feminist field or a supposed debate between French social science and Anglo-American social science, but one that had the contribution of Catholic activists and thinkers who finally engaged directly with academic debates. In 2013, and this is just a vignette, following the call from the Archbishop of Warsaw, about 10,000 people marched in support of the French opponents to same-sex marriage. So the opposition was also globalized and trans-European. But the curious thing is that they showed banners against gender theory, adding a totally new meaning to academic influence on society. So suddenly you go out on the streets and you have banners against gender ideology and gender theory. It is accused of all the things that we take for granted, okay? That it denies biological reality, that it imposes notions of masculinity and femininity as culturally relative, and so on and so forth. These become accusations. In the French case, it was felt that an old association between family forms and republicanism was being threatened. If we see universal republicanism as the specifically French version of nationalism, of course. In the Polish case, Catholicism was the scaffolding, or is the scaffolding, of a certain type of national identity among conservative sectors in the post-socialist period. So in both cases, what is at stake is a reaction against social change, loss of sovereignty, and change in the ethnic landscape. Family and reproduction in a specific heteronormative and gender binary set is seen as the crucial anchor to save societies from that sort of decadence. I'm coming to the end, just three, okay, I'll try to. So the attack on gender theory has, however, been having some advantages. It brings gender back to center stage. The centrality recently given to LGBT rights in international and national discussions could end up hiding the issues of gender inequality and women's rights. It is the result of a historical separatism between feminism and LGBT movements, a separatism that, in my view, is theoretically and politically wrong, and that needs to be superseded. Some currents in the LGBT movement, as well as some political instances in some states, end up establishing a conceptual and political divorce between the wider issues of gender and the issues of LGBT rights. The latter seen as more specific and not as structural elements of gender configurations, like Gail Rubin taught us so many years ago. I'll have to jump a little part here and come to the conclusion, and it reads like this. If we were to look at the world from above, I think we would notice that something historically new is happening. It is historically new in the sense that the social actors were not there before to talk to us. Gay and lesbian people were not there before to talk to us. They were hidden, and so was the issue of LGBT identities as deserving of rights. But they were there all along, of course, as the medical, psychiatric, and social sciences were constructing definitions of the normal and the abnormal. The occultation, repression, or denial of same-sex desire and relations, or of gender-deviant manifestations, was the building block of a certain vision of gender and kinship in the social sciences, and of the very institutional dynamics of gender and kinship in the West and its colonies. We wouldn't have built a whole canon of kinship studies without the occultation of same-sex desire and relations, I'm sorry to say. We would also notice, of course, that in the contemporary landscape, the LGBT designation tends to be a G designation, with the hegemony of male representations, as well as Western, white, and middle-class ones, revealing parallels with the wider political economy of race, class, and global power. We would also notice that certain contexts present LGBT rights as a mark of progress, actually reiterating the notion of progress with a capital P, whether intervening in their defense, punishing those who do not comply, or practicing pinkwashing or homonationalism and other concepts like that, which I couldn't go into. We would also notice that those contexts correspond to geographies of power in a long colonial and post-colonial history, that of Euro-America and its expansion, but in a situation of growing decline and multipolarity. The same contexts that systematized homosexual perversion and illness and that promoted the heteronormative evangelization of the colonized world are now electing LGBT rights as the symbol of modernizing avant-garde. We would also notice that certain contexts, those that lost in the colonial imperial dispute, elect the LGBT person as the new pariah, attributing its origin to the West and the colonizer, as the enemy within, the foreign other, the contaminator of family, gender, and children, as defined by tradition, religion, or biology. We would also notice that both sides exist within each side. Anywhere, disputes about the LGBT person, her status and freedom, reveal anxiety about the gender order, especially when it comes to decisions about what family forms are to be allowed in the social contract as symbolically deserving the support of the state and the law. Thank you very much.
Great, thanks very much, Miguel, and thank you to all the three presenters for now for three almost, I'd say almost miraculously consistent and complementary perspectives on kinship and gender. So it's now over to our discussant, Elisabeth Kitsoglu from the from Durham University. She's here in a capacity as a representative of the ASA, of the Association for Social Anthropologists, but also as a scholar of gender and kinship, having studied gender and kinship in Greece for many years. And since I've mentioned a couple of other books, okay, I'd like to mention Elisabeth's monograph as well, For the Love of Women, Gender, Identity, and Same-Sex Relations in the Greek provincial town from 2004. Now, for some reason, three of the four books I've mentioned in this panel have been from 2004, which must have been something of an anno mirabilis in the contemporary theorizing of gender and kinship. So, Elisabeth, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm painfully conscious of the time, so I will try to not to take much of the discussion time away. I would just like to start by thanking warmly the organizers of this conference and the EASA for returning the invitation. We had also an EASA ambassador in our ASA conference that happened less than 2 weeks ago. And that conference, which we hosted in Durham, had a remarkably similar theme to this one. It was called Footprints and Futures, the Time of Anthropology. And I think that this similarity of the two themes is a fortunate synchronization in anthropological concerns about Europe, and it signals the need for further cooperation and collaborations between the various anthropological associations. To our theme now, kinship, yes, indeed, about relationality, personhood, law, naturalization, gender, and the continuous intertwining of these themes. It is also a shorthand term that we use to describe the culturally meaningful ways people around the world attempt to emplace themselves in multiple temporalities, in pasts and in futures. I'd say kinship is also about legacies, the legacies of those who precede us in time and the legacies we want to create for ourselves vis-a-vis those who will come after us. As part of an ESRC project, I had the opportunity to conduct fieldwork last summer in Greece on the so-called migration crisis, refugee crisis. A Saturday afternoon, a local Greek woman, Maria, came to a small NGO in Lesbos holding a loaf of bread. Not any bread, the kind of bread that women usually take to the church to become Holy Communion. Folded in a clean, white linen cloth and accompanied with the names of her family's dead to be commemorated during Sunday Mass, as usually, this bread never found its way to the church. It came to the refugees. The bearer asked that it is given instead to the refugees to eat and commemorate the dead of her family in an obvious symbolical parable with the Sunday Mass. All my family, she said, my mother, my father, my grandparents, were refugees from Asia Minor, and she was referring to the Greco-Turkish War in 1922-24. It is those refugees today that are best suitable to honor the memory of my dead kin. And Maria worked throughout the summer and the winter alongside the refugees who she felt, in her own words, as kin, stressing that she was honoring the legacy of her parents. She was doing this to honor the legacy of her parents. And then, of course, there are other ways to think about kinship as legacy that defies laws and is built in between the cracks and indeterminacies of legal systems. Marriage, perhaps simply coupling, or as Sophia, a woman who currently lives and raises a daughter with her parent Kelly in Greece, calls this jokingly, coupling with consequences. I know Sophia and Kelly since my first fieldwork that resulted in the For the Love of Women, and in their own words, literally created their daughter using a range of different assisted reproductive technologies. They stood before the law, of course, not as a couple, but as single women, very similarly to what Miguel, did you say that? Yeah. Anyway, yeah. But as single women, exploiting the very naturalistic assumption of legal structures that women, married or single, have this automatic right to motherhood. And we've heard that as well. Did they manage to defy these structures by doing that? No, of course they didn't, because we know that there is still a lot of discrimination going on. But at least, up to an extent, I'd say that all these examples, all these people, they managed to queer those structures. They managed to destabilize them. They paved the way for change, for the production of new terms, for the production of new understandings, of new ways of describing the life projects of actual people. Kelly and Maria, they're not the first, Sophia, they're not the first nor the last ones to do this. Every person who does this before them and after them is actually creates in a kind of legacy, a legacy for others to follow, to defy, to defend, to disagree, but certainly to question, to talk about, not to take as granted, not to take as natural. So yes, what anthropologists call kinship and gender are everywhere, but not only as aspects of structures. Crucially, as sets of experience governed and mediated by our radical imagination, by our capacity to create alternative worlds, not just find worlds and classify them. And of course, by our resilience as political subjects who continue to struggle despite all kinds of adversities. Yes, they exist everywhere, in the way we relate to others and the way we understand ourselves as connected and interconnected to contemporaries, people who live next to us, but also to this whole other world that contains the shadows of the dead and the glimpses of those yet to be born. And this is definitely a world of legacies and futures. And exploiting my position here as a discussant, I would like to ask a question, the first question. Inspired by Miguel, who said that gender is being brought back to the central stage, and all the other talks, and Jeanette, who said that the future trajectory of kinship and gender will depend on their explanatory potential. Well, I'm saying that my question is that kinship and gender as experiences will, of course, continue to exist regardless of our capacity to actually describe them, of our academic capacity to engage with them as categories. But as categories of analysis, yes, they depend on their academic potential. So how do you exactly, and this is a question for all of you, how do you evaluate this explanatory potential of those categories at present? And thank you very much.
So, thanks very much, Elizabeth. Does anybody in the panel want to comment on the comments? Feel free to do so. Otherwise, we'll move on directly to questions from the audience. Right, we move on directly to questions from the audience. There's one over there. Where? So can you, yeah. And can you just please state your name?
Hi, my name is Taylor Riley. I have a question for Miguel, but I really enjoyed all of the presentations and I wish I could address all of them. I just wanted to ask, you speak really eloquently about these problems of trying to understand debates around homosexuality in Africa in the contemporary, in our post-colonial world. And I wonder, outside of maybe ethnographic research, if you have any musings on how we can destabilize these very Eurocentric notions of progress, because I think that's very difficult work, because that's seen as something that would be inherently homophobic to destabilize marriage rights and things, because the antithesis then is, well, a heteronormative society. But I wanted to share an example from South Africa where rural indigenous people have actually quite a ambivalence or even tolerance of homosexuality a lot of the time. Of course, sometimes they don't. But they actually fear that if they speak out against the new laws that promote, you know, gay marriage and things, that they'll be jailed like they were in apartheid. And so it's a very, I think, precarious situation. And I wonder if you have any, you know, further thoughts on that. How do we destabilize this notion of progress, but, you know, maintain kind of positive directions?
So, would you like to respond? Oh, yeah. Yeah, but you have to press, just remember to press the button and press it again when you're finished.
Okay, so I'll do it quickly. Okay, I think I'll take advantage of what you said and expand it a little bit. My problem is our problem. It's very similar to the issue of the universality of human rights, the whole discussion about that. So what we need to do as anthropologists, but mostly those of us who are involved with some sort of public anthropology or who study social movements and so on, is to actually find what kinds of idiom or what kinds of dynamics people have in very specific places to uphold certain types of human rights, namely gender and LGBT rights. You see? Because the way that people do it is different in different societies and within the plurality of each society, you know, whether it's an urban or rural area and so on and so forth. And to find that, to find how a local notion of progress in the sense of a change that allows for encompassing more people into the collective rights can be done. And I think anthropologists are crucial for that because they can have the this distanced observation, but for a very long time, that allows them to help
help people identify their ways of doing things, because we don't always, as we know from our personal experience, we don't always know how to do things. We don't reflect about how we do things. And so anthropologists can be extremely useful in providing mirrors. Right? It's not the codification of ethnography to be used by people. That's not what I mean. It's a dialogue that goes on in the field and that allows you to provide the mirror. Just to give you a very short example. For instance, in a country like mine, where all the pro-LGBT laws have been approved, I mean everything, we've got the whole legal package, and still there's a lot of homophobia, and very few people are out of the closet. So this is a contradiction. Well, it is a contradiction if you look at it from a British or a Scandinavian point of view. It's not a contradiction if you anthropologically know how much people depend on family ties in order to get a job or to survive, right? And then you start understanding that probably you can play with different resources and still make advancements in the legal level, which, as we all sort of agreed here, in a way, I think, directly or indirectly, continues to be an incredibly strong authoritative moral source for the way that people live in society. Yeah.
Very good. So we can take another question. There's one over there. Oh, yeah, over there first, and then right. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. My name is Rachel Spronk from the University of Amsterdam. And I'd like to thank Janet Carsten and Marit Melhuus for bringing back kinship studies and to undo it from certain legacies, but also to show its potential for understanding many things that we do, may not understand in the first instance. And that's my comment to Miguel. I know you're not working on Africa, so you're excused, because the interesting thing is that kinship will help us understand, or kinship is actually rendering LGBT lives or same-sex intimacies possible in a country like Uganda. So that is the interesting twist here, that through fictive kinship relations, or sometimes other kinship structures, same people engage maybe sometimes in opposite sex relationships because they become a parent, also can, are able to engage in same-sex relationships. And that is not a contradiction. It is if you apply to a legal framework which has become our grid of understanding our own sexualities and genders. So it is that what I wanted to point out, how to understand the extreme violent homophobic reactions in a country like Uganda, yet many people live their same-sex lives. And kinship will help us to understand this larger contradiction.
I certainly don't want to monopolize this, but just to say, it follows from what we just were dialoguing before about. It's we as social scientists that can do what you're doing so well. You know, identify what are practices, what are norms, and what is our laws in the state. I mean, my objects of study and what I presented were the states and the governments and not the peoples or the cultures or anything like that. And it's showing that difference and the dynamic, sometimes contradictory between the two, that is really important. At the same time, criticizing whether there's a model of gender or LGBT rights that tends to be Eurocentric and that may not work in certain places. But it's very tricky, as you know, political issue. Yeah. So.
Yes, I mean there's a dance, the dance of the fixed and the fluid, which is also one of the meta themes of anthropological theorizing, I guess. I believe we have a question over there. If there's a microphone nearby, up there. Right, you've got it. Okay, you first, and then this gentleman.
I think I snuck in there. Thank you for three really great papers and a very lovely commentary on them. And it always strikes me that, I mean, we've clearly done played a lot of very, there's been some excellent scholarship over the past two decades on kinship. And there's clearly been fruitful and productive attention to kinship. And I'm wondering whether we've done the same for gender, and whether, in fact, we're a bit of a step behind some of the multiplicity, in a sense, of gendered entities, including the denial of gendered bodies. That's part of a contemporary political activism. It strikes me when, Marit, you were talking about this twist that have gone on, and again, it's still twisting that those laws, that people still imagine sperm going to men and eggs going to women. They don't imagine eggs going to couples or eggs going to men, basically. So, and then you talked about gender equality and gender bias, and so I'm wondering whether we're all working anthropologically with a bit of an impoverished or restricted possibilities of the concept of gender, that in fact, in the world as it's kind of evolving, emerging at the moment, there's much more interesting things going on that we may be a little step behind.
I think I agree with what you said initially, that we've done much more work on kinship than on gender. And I also don't know how it is on the different departments around Europe of those who are gathered here, but the interest in gender is absolutely falling at my department. I mean, there are very few people who come to their PhD projects with gender as a major dimension of what they're doing. And to the one who was asking how to argue for the explanatory potential of these concepts, and I think even if you're studying climate or water or overheating, as long as you're involved in people's everyday lives, somehow these dimensions are present. They don't necessarily have to be the main, but there's something going on here that I'm not able to put words on either. Maybe somebody else is. When it comes to, maybe Janet can say something more about, I would actually like to throw the question maybe back at you, Jeanette. Maybe you have thought a bit more about how we can expand in a sense that we're caught in the trap of the old way of thinking, and I see your point very well. I mean, and how to escape it so that we actually take that whole discussion further and make it more provocative and more interesting. I don't have an answer, but I agree with you that something needs to be done. I don't know if there's a potential there that we haven't tapped, I'm sure. Mm.
Okay. So for now, let's just sort of keep it in mind and move on to the next question.
So I have a question, especially for Marit Melhuus. I sound too loud, but hopefully I don't sound too loud to you. A lot of you brought up different ways that there are inclusions and exclusions related to kinship and related to gender, and I'm super glad that you did that. I think that's very important in today's world, especially related to immigration, all the different ways that Europe and other places are involved in drawing boundaries and xenophobia. Within the academy, which is largely a heteronormative and gender binary normative system, I also wonder what it does when we state that men who are legally fathers are in a certain way mothers, or pregnant is a new thing. And part of the reason I bring that up is that I have a student who did a thesis 2 years ago where he worked with over 40 men, people who identified as men who had been pregnant. And in looking through his thesis just now, saw several articles that were published years ago about this, working with many different people. And given that none of us knows who's sitting next to us or who is among us, which of us, those of us who are transgender in this room or are not, or are gender non-conforming, etc. There were certain moments during your talk when, for example, when you read the statement about an egg should not be transferred to the uterus of another person, with the word person, and the audience kind of laughed. And I'm wondering how that feels as an inclusion or exclusion to people who might not fit the norms of this kind of academic environment in general. So I don't know exactly how to ask that except to push back a little bit. and to thank you for focusing on what you focused on.
Well, I can't take the responsibility for the audience laughing. I can take responsibility if I formulated myself in a way that evoked a laughter. It wasn't my intention, but it is interesting that how, I think my point in part was, I haven't, this law in Norway is so new that I haven't actually pursued it any further, and I don't really know what's happening. But the implications of the legal change is that you have to go through and change all the documents, and I think that was part of my point. And I think on a more general level, I have another point to make, which has to do with the state and the state's need to see who we are, to identify us as persons. And I think that the possibility of this new law, which I find is quite radical, that you actually can self-declare your gender, and you know, it's a radical good law to be put in place, and there's no demands, you just fill in the form. I think that is possible. I mean, there's been a discussion, should they change the passports, should it be a third gender category? But I mean, in a very short time, we don't need gender to identify who, in a short time already, we don't need gender to identify who a person, the state doesn't need gender. We have biometrics, we have person numbers, we have a whole set of other categories to classify and identify a person. So even our naming, our surnames in Norway, the laws on surnames have been totally liberalized. Before it was very strict who could take what surname. Now it's totally liberalized because surnames don't necessarily, according to the state perspective, are not necessary to identify who you are. They use the person number and they use the biometrics. So I mean, it's in part of this discussion that I'm also a bit interested in how these changes also evolve.
Yes, I mean, and Janet reminded us during her talk about the significance of continuing to study personhood. So this sort of feeds back into that problem. I think I haven't seen any more questions, and people are starting to drift out. Oh, there's one over there. We'll have a last question, and then I have some practical information, so don't leave quite yet. Two short questions.
I'll just make it really short so that you can also get it. I was just wondering that with all the gender talk, and in the USA, they are debating about who can use which bathroom and toilet. But you know, one thing I really want to know is what is the role of anthropologists when these legalities are constructed? I mean, maybe I missed in your talk, but I just want to know, are anthropologists at all consulted when these laws are made about gender and identity in Norway or anywhere else, and whether as anthropologists we can actually play a role, somehow have a say, because our subject is based on kinship and gender and all these things, and we are the ones who can actually provide substantial contribution to a debate, a social debate on this issue.
Thank you. We'll then just move straight on to the last question.
Yeah, it's about almost in the same line, and the question was about what role anthropologists can have in the public debate, and I'm just wondering, because just as you were talking, I've got a message from a Catholic newspaper from Italy who wants to know what is going on inside this session. And also in Italy, of course, there has been a great debate about new reproductive technologies and the gender theory. So, yeah.
Who wants to comment?
Well, I can comment briefly. I think you have a lot more to say, because our roles here have probably been very different in this. But when it comes to in the case of Norway and the new reproductive technologies, that the role of anthropologists, several, has been not directly involved in the law, but in the public sessions that the Biotechnology Advisory Board organizes, you're invited to give a talk, and then you read later the documents that some of your arguments have fed into the documents that come out the other end. It's that kind of thing. Whereas in the UK, I mean, Marilyn Strathern has been quite involved, actually, in a lot of that. And you are politically, I mean, here, you've been writing the laws. Yeah.
So it is then time to thank you all for having given us a wonderful afternoon and lots to think about.